Hey everybody, I'm Andy Hill. I'm Dean of the Film Scoring Academy of Europe in Sofia, Bulgaria, and its Director of Studies. And we're actually recording this in our classroom in Sofia right now. And I want to give a shout out to all my friends at the Memphis Music Bank and any other aspiring film, television, or video game composers who might be checking this video out. Now, I've been asked to do a short primer on music theory for this series. And if you're a graduate of the Juilliard School in New York or the Guildhall School of Music in London, you can go on to the next video because there probably won't be anything for you in this one. But if, like me, you were a self-taught musician, ear-trained, and coming to this a little bit later in life, there may be some really valuable things in this lesson for you. So let's get into it. I want to start by reviewing some basics and see if we can get everybody more or less on the same page. And again, if this is material you're thoroughly familiar with, you can go ahead and fast forward to the sections of the video that are more interesting to you. When we study music theory, the first useful piece of information we usually get has to do with scales, major and minor, with the minor scale having a couple of variations. We learn that the major scale is made up of two tetrachords, four-note sets. This goes back to the Greeks, as so much about music does, with each tetrachord comprising the same sequence of intervals, that is, whole step, half step, or tone, tone, semitone. If we begin with C as our tonic, it's C, D, E, F, that's the bottom tetrachord, and G, A, B, C, that's the top tetrachord. But of course, C can be any pitch, and this is why the solfège system used in Europe, it's called a movable do. As long as those two tetrachords stack up in the same way, it's still a major scale. The pitch that the scale begins and ends with, and the number of sharps or flats we need to insert to preserve the interval structure, determines its key signature. For years after we learned this, and maybe for the rest of our musical lives, pretty much everything we do relates back to this notion of key. Just about every pop, folk, or country song you can name has a fixed key signature. If it begins in A major, it will usually end in A major. That's unless, of course, the songwriter has decided to insert one of those big modulations at the end of the song for the final chorus, in which case it may end in another key. But generally speaking, it ends where it begins. That's home. And home is a very important concept in popular music. Now, one of the first things we learn about film music is that it often has no fixed home. Or more accurately, it leaves home and sometimes never goes back, finding other temporary homes along the way. If it does make its way back to that original home, it takes its sweet time about it and enjoys the trip. The trip is the story. And as we know, every story has its ups and downs, its triumphs and tragedies, its bitter and its sweet. The job of a film composer is to tell that story with music, and that's what we're talking about today. We'll get back to that storytelling aspect later, but first, let's return to the fundamentals. Literally, if we had a thoughtful music theory teacher in high school or as undergraduates in college, he or she probably told us that all scales are derived from the overtone series, which is a fact of nature, just like the color spectrum. If we pluck a string or blow a pipe or hammer an anvil, we produce a tone that is called the fundamental. The C string on a cello is an example. But ranging above that fundamental are dozens and dozens of overtones that resonate with it, They're also known as harmonics. They are multiples of that fundamental in a fixed whole number ratio to it. The first overtone of our C string on the cello is another C, an octave above it. And that ratio is 2:1. The second overtone is a G, a perfect fifth above that second C. And the ratio is 3:2. This was all figured out by a guy named Pythagoras back in ancient Greece. Overtone number 4 is another C. So we have C, C, G, C, yet another octave up. And by the time we get to overtone number 5, we arrive at an E natural, the middle voice, the third in a C major triad. Here's what the overtone series looks like. So here in the bass clef, two ledger lines below the staff, is our fundamental C. Again, talking about using the cello as a reference. Here's the first overtone, another C above that. Second overtone, G, a perfect fifth above that second C. Overtone number 4, we jump up to another C, and this is what we know as middle C, or C3. Here's our fifth overtone, that E natural. Our sixth overtone, we have another G. Now we have the constituents of a C major triad. You can see that, right? C, E, G. Here's where it gets interesting. Overtone number 7 is a B flat. Now this triad, this chord, excuse me, is known as a C7, or a dominant seventh chord. Overtone number 8, another C. Overtone number 9, a D natural. Number 10, a second E natural. Number 11, this is interesting, F sharp. Its relationship to C, to the fundamental, would be that of an augmented fourth. We won't get into exactly why this figures into the overtone series, but we can kind of ignore it for now. Overtone 12 takes us back to G. Now, if we continue up this overtone series, eventually we will have all the tones that constitute a C major scale. And the same will be true if we start from any other fundamental pitch. The ancient Greek modes, which I'm sure you've heard of at some point, and the medieval church modes derived from them and used in what we call Gregorian chant, were essentially systematizations of this overtone series we just talked about. You may have heard of some of the more famous ones because they're widely used in global folk music and in the blues, rock, and country music that emerged from folk music. Imagine a piano with no black keys. Now that's just an octave, C to C, white keys only. The mode that spans the octave between C and C is called Ionian, better known to us as a major scale. The mode that covers the distance between D and the next D up is called Dorian. Still using only the white keys and within an octave. And Dorian mode is probably the principal mode used in Celtic folk music, as well as a whole lot of both rock and film music. The iconic theme from the spaghetti western, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, is a great example, and I'm going to play it for you now so you can hear the Dorian mode in practice.
Thank you.
Now, you've all heard that, and I'm going to guess that most of us love that sound. People will describe the Dorian mode as having a kind of epic, timeless quality. So it's used in a lot of historical epics. It's used in a lot of video games. It's used in series like Game of Thrones. It's used by composers like Hans Zimmer and Thomas Newman, and in this case, the great Ennio Morricone. Now, the modes look like this, and they are defined as either major or minor modes based on their third degree, their third scale degree, which is going to be either a major or minor third. Mode one, we already identified as Ionian, otherwise known as our major scale. And you can see, here it is. Mode two, Dorian. There's that minor third, D to F, that's the interval of a minor third. The interesting thing about Dorian and what gives it that sort of epic quality is that it has a major six right there, which means that the tonic chord is a D minor, but the four chord is a G major. That's a very distinctive sound. And then it has a flat seven. Mode three, which we often associate with the Middle East and sometimes with the flamenco music of Spain, is called Phrygian. It's interesting because it has a flat second. It starts on the E, but it's this. That gives it that sort of dark, mysterious, exotic flavor. That's Phrygian. It has a minor, it has a flat second degree. Mode four is called Lydian. This is used a lot in film music. I mentioned Tom Newman. This is a favorite of his and many other composers, James Newton Howard. It was probably first made an iconic film music convention by Elmer Bernstein in the score for To Kill a Mockingbird. We'll listen to a bit of that later. Lydian starts in the classic series of modes on F. And it's a major mode because the interval between F and A, between the first and third degree, is a major third. But it's on that fourth degree where it gets interesting. Because the interval between F and B is a tritone, or in this case, an augmented fourth. Now you might recognize that if you've seen Steven Spielberg's adaptation of West Side Story, you might recognize that interval. As the melody from Maria. West Side Story is full of augmented fourths. Mode five, Mixolydian, also really popular in rock, folk, and film music. Again, it's a major mode beginning on G. There's that major third. But it has a flat seven, which means that if you're writing a chord progression in Lydian, your seven chord is an F major chord. Again, a really distinctive sound. Mode six, we finally get back to something we know from our very first music theory class, and that is the Aeolian or natural minor scale, beginning on A. And it's characteristic that third and six, distinctive natural minor flavor. And finally, mode 7-1, you're not going to hear a whole lot other than maybe in jazz music, and that's the Locrian mode, starting on B. Now, it's got a flat second for its second degree, a minor third, a diminished fifth, you can see why it's not used that much. It has a pretty odd flavor. But there you have it. Those are the modes. So you notice there, if you were paying attention, that the first and sixth modes, Ionian and Aeolian, are identical in their interval makeup to what we call the major and natural minor scales. Only in early music, prior to the 18th century and prior to the invention of equal temperament or the adoption of equal temperament. In those days, they had to be based on these fundamentals, on C and A. So we had Ionian and Aeolian. Again, if you play these white keys on the piano, you notice one is just simply a variation of the other. One starts on C, the other starts on A. These are called relative keys, and that is because of the phenomenon of common tones. We'll get to that a bit later. For nearly eight centuries, this is how it was. You wrote modally. And the modes were our common musical materials. You're going to notice as we go along that a whole lot of film music is still modal in style. Okay, so the next thing that our thoughtful, caring music theory teacher is going to introduce is something called the circle of fifths. This concept popped up in music theory in the late 17th century, and for more than two centuries, it was the common basis for harmonic progressions in the Western world. And to this day, whether you're aware of it or not, you still write chord progressions based on root movement by fifths. C major, G major, C major, F major, 1, 4, and 5. Popular song as we know it, from Stephen Foster to Billie Eilish, wouldn't be possible without harmony driven by fifth relationships. Here's what that circle of fifths looks like. The circle of fifths gives us a graphic and super easy way to understand key signatures. Because with each rise or drop of the tonic pitch, the key pitch, by a perfect fifth, we add a sharp or a flat, depending on which direction we're moving around the circle. The chord symbols in black are the major keys, and those in gray are their relative minor keys. For instance, C major and how often have you heard that progression in pop music? It's the very basis of what we call doo-wop music, the music that infused the 1950s and inspired the musical Grease. Major chord, relative minor chord. From the circle of fifths, we move into the age of counterpoint, figured bass, and the kind of harmony many of us learn in school or church choirs. This is the stuff that forms the core of all basic music theory education in the West. Lots of folks will say that the highest expression of diatonic harmony, that is, harmony based upon the major and minor scales, is the Bach chorales, a series of pieces written by Johann Sebastian Bach. Here's a typical example.
Thank you.
beautiful, comforting, balanced, some would say a sort of portrait of musical perfection. And to this day, if you listen to one of Adele's classic ballads, you're basically going to be hearing the same kind of harmony that was used by Bach. Power ballads, love songs, particularly in the realm of pop music as opposed to jazz, generally use this kind of harmony. But it's not just Bach. It's not just old stuff. We could just as well cite an example like this.
Sought the Lord, and He answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on Him are radiant, they'll never be ashamed, they'll never be ashamed. This Corvette cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemies. The Son of God surrounds His saints. He will deliver them. He will deliver them.
Okay, again, beautiful, comforting, balanced. Same kind of chord progression used by Johann Sebastian Bach. Mostly, we're talking about 1, 6, 4, 5. Those four chords constitute the bulk of the chord progression in this song. Now, that doesn't sound like a lot of contemporary film music unless we're talking about Mr. Zimmer, for example, who still favors in his progressions diatonic harmony. Lion King, a picture that I worked very hard on and consumed an important part of my life, is a good example of that.
When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see, no, I won't be afraid. Oh, I won't be afraid, just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand. Stand by me. Stand by me.
Okay, that's the great Benny King, and that's Stand By Me. Now that's in the key of A major. Guess what the second chord is? F sharp minor. That's the sixth chord in the scale of A major. And then, so four chords again, just like we heard in that gospel tune, and like we'll often see in the music of Bach. 1, 6, 4, 5, and back to 1. Now let me just show you the 7 triads built on the degrees of the major scale, labeled both by their chord symbols and the Roman numerals that have long been used in harmonic analysis to describe their function, something we probably won't get to today. The root of each triad can be reached through movement by the interval of a perfect fifth. Remember the circle of fifths. For more than 3 centuries, the strongest chord progressions have been considered by theorists to be those characterized by root movement in fifths. And you can still write a hit by following those guidelines, or a piece for a gospel choir, or even for an orchestra. Here's what they look like. Okay, what we're looking at here are the triads of the major scale. In this case, we're using our old friend C major. C major is always a very convenient place to reference music theory discussions from, because again, we're just dealing with the white keys on the piano. C major, that's the one chord, the tonic chord. D minor, that's the two chord. That's called the supertonic, if you're interested. E minor, that's the mediant. F major, subdominant. G major, dominant. A minor, submediant. And here it gets interesting, because the 7 chord in a major scale is a diminished chord, okay? It's got a diminished fifth. And back up to C. You don't need any more than those 7 chords to write a hit, if you're of a mind to, and you want to write something in that familiar, comforting, conventional, expected way. But we're talking about film music. And again, the film, a narrative film, 80, 90, 100 minutes in length, tells a story. And that story goes through lots of changes. And the characters, hopefully, if the script is written well, go through lots of changes too. There's just no way that music that remains fixed in this diatonic universe is going to provide a very effective journey through that world. As I said at the top, the best film music often has no fixed home, because it's obliged to follow the story. The story rarely, if ever, has a single home. But there's another purely musical reason for this, and it gets into the area of psychoacoustics, the way we hear sound and music, how our brain processes it, how we respond emotionally to it. And also in things discussed in books like This Is Your Brain on Music, which, if you haven't read it, is a really great read. After those 3 centuries of everybody pretty much operating in the same universe, we're so accustomed to diatonic chord progressions that when we hear, say, the 2 chord, D minor, followed by the 5 chord, G major, we anticipate that the next chord will be C major. These cadences have become predictable to us. And one thing film music can't be is predictable. Not unless the on-screen action is predictable, and when something is that predictable, we usually characterize it as bad, or at least not terribly interesting, and we get up to use the bathroom, or have a smoke break, or to answer a phone call, because we know what's going to happen. We've seen this movie before. You don't want people to feel that way about your music. Now, there are instances in a classic 3-act movie that are predictable and need to be, because the audience expectation is of these things, and if you don't meet those expectations, they may not be happy with the experience they had in the movie. So, for example, the arrival of the hero to save the day, the kiss after scene after scene of flirtation between the two main characters, or maybe even the last gasp, the death rattle in a big death scene. Those things can be predictable, and the music can go to more predictable places when you're scoring a scene like that. The fact that most film music has no fixed key signature doesn't make it atonal. The fact is, you can drop into most film scores at any given point and identify some sort of tonal center, some sort of temporary home. Usually it's established by a drone, a pedal, or a pad. So, for example, sticking with the key of C for a second, if we establish this pad, right? Now, those two chords, C major and D major, don't actually belong in the same diatonic key signature. But because we have this pedal here, right, the pedal establishes a kind of ground of the cue, and we can go where we need to go in terms of the chord progression, and the audience will still feel somewhat grounded musically. Doesn't always have to happen, but it often does. And the thing about those tonal centers, those apparent tonal centers, is that they're momentary, they're transient, just like the events in the film. Hero in one scene, villain in the next. Happiness darkening to tragedy. In a familiar world, one moment, but when we step through that secret door in the closet, we're in a different universe. That's how film operates, and the music needs to follow it there. So tonality, or key, in film music floats. There are various names for this kind of harmony. Post-tonal is probably the biggest umbrella term, but terms like pan-triadic and pan-diatonic may actually describe it better. In film music, we can move from any triad to any other triad anywhere in the triadic universe. The key to doing this smoothly is what's called voice leading. And the trick is usually to preserve common tones as you move from one chord to the other. The most basic kind of voice leading known to all musicians and songwriters is what we can call an R transformation, which is moving from a major triad to its relative minor. For example, from C major to A minor. Two tones are preserved, C and E. One moves by a whole tone from G to A. An equally common modulation takes us from, say, C major to the key of its dominant, G major. Now, this is only the beginning. When we study tonal music, we learn that a triad can be built on each note in a diatonic scale, simply by stacking intervals of a third, either three or four semitones, depending on whether the triad is major or minor. And we've already looked at those chords in the key of C major. In the key of A minor, the chords are A minor, then to our B diminished, to C major, to D minor, to E minor, to F major, to G major, to A. And again, you can still write great songs using nothing more than those triads. That diminished triad keeps finding its way in because of the half step between B and C and E and F. Why those half steps are there in the diatonic system goes back to the overtone series, but just as a preview of things to come, you can also make up a scale composed entirely of whole steps. It's known as a whole tone scale. And that will yield some really interesting chords, many of them augmented. Whole tone scales are especially good at depicting underwater and outer space scenes in movies. And let's start on C again. Now, if we construct chords there, you're going to end up, again, with a lot of augmented triads, which is part of what creates that watery, floaty sense. As beginners, we learn that these diatonic chords are linked by the position of their roots in the circle of fifths, and also by their function in Western harmony. The first chord progression that most of us learn is either 1-4-5-1, or maybe 1-2-5-1. That dominant chord, G, in the key of C major, has a dominant function because it contains this leading tone. Where does that want to go? It wants to go there. So that G major wants to lead to C major. It has a dominant function. If the chord is a dominant seventh, like this, or let me spell it like this, it has an even stronger leading tone function. Because that diminished fifth interval between B and F natural, which is dissonant, dissonant intervals very much want to resolve to consonant intervals. This kind of functional relationship is the basis of all Western diatonic harmony from Palestrina to Garth Brooks. But there's a way to connect chords and progression that has nothing to do with this sort of function and works far better in this floaty world of film, where the function of music is to tell a story. Now let's look at one way to string together triads that has nothing to do with conventional function. The triads in what one theorist has called the hexatonic trance are all connected by having two shared tones in common. Only one of the notes or voices in the triad has to move in order to make a new chord, and it never moves by more than a semitone, that's a half step, or occasionally a whole tone. But for example, this hexatonic track, and let's just stay in C major because it makes things really easy. Okay, we start with a C major triad. Now I want to get to another chord, moving only one voice by only one semitone. That chord is C minor. Now from C minor, I want to move again to a different chord, but I only want a voice to move by a single semitone. So I've gone. Now I go. Okay? That's an A flat major chord. Now I want to get to yet another chord, but the rule is I can only move one voice and only by one semitone. Okay? That's an A flat minor or enharmonic G sharp minor. Now I want to go from there, and again, same rule, one voice, one semitone. That's going to take me to E major. Now here's the journey I've taken. C major to C minor to A flat major to A flat minor to E major. Now, one more, I got one more, and I can only move a single voice, so I'm going to drop my G sharp by a semitone to G natural, make it an E minor chord, and now I can go back to C. Now the voice leading there is really smooth. No voice ever has to move by more than a semitone. only one note in the chord changes. But it doesn't sound like this. It's not predictable. It sounds like this. And that begins to sound more like film music. Here's what it sounds like with all those chords played together. Now, when we listen to that Bach, and we listen to the gospel choir, and we listen to Benny King singing Stand By Me, I said that the quality was comforting, balanced, familiar. This is less familiar and less comforting. But when we go to the movies and we want to be transported to some alien universe we haven't even imagined in our dreams, we don't want necessarily to be comforted. We don't want necessarily for it to feel like home. We want it to feel like someplace else. Now, this group of chords I just played you is called hexatonic because there are just six chords instead of the seven that characterize the diatonic system. Looking at this on paper, you might say, wait a second, I learned in music theory that you can't put C major and C minor together in the same chord progression because they come from two completely different scales. In fact, if we use C minor in a song that's in the key of C major, usually our music theory instructors will say we borrowed that chord or it's a mixed chord from a different scale. Not true in film music. In film music, the scale is that suits the support of the story and the journey that you want to take with the movie. And by the way, this mixing of modes is something the Beatles did all the time. It didn't seem to hurt their career. But if we listen carefully again to that one change, say from A flat or from A flat minor to E major, voiced in the second inversion with its fifth on the bottom, we begin to hear something that sounds like film music. Another way to pull out some really interesting chord changes is to take a cue from a 19th century German music theorist by the name of Carl Friedrich Weizmann. Now, Weizmann had a kind of eccentric theory that all triadic harmony was derived from the augmented triad. The theory doesn't seem to have held up all that well, but if we begin with the augmented triad, do the same sort of thing we did with that hexatonic trance scale, preserving a common tone and keeping the movement of the voices to a tone or semitone, get some pretty cool sounding changes. Here's the C augmented chord. Here's an A flat major chord. Here's that A flat minor chord. Here, now we can go to there. Ooh, that's different. Then we can go here, and here back to there. Now listen again to that row, and I'll play it for you here. Little spooky, right? A little mysterious, a little eerie, like a lot of movies, right? We want to be transported, and the music has to be able to transport us, and harmony is the main way you do that. Speaking of weird things that are done by film composers, it's not all that unusual or uncommon for film music to occupy two entirely different key centers at once. So, we could have something that was done a lot by the great Russian composer Igor Stravinsky, and is done a whole lot better than I can in this example from the great John Williams. Okay, and thanks to Pierce Hackard for that beautiful reduction. We all know this, of course. This is the first victim cue from the first Jaws, the film that made both Steven Spielberg and John Williams' careers take off like a rocket. What key is that in? Who knows? This... The pitches are E and F, so most people sort of assume that's our pedal. But he does this. You heard that seventh. But then he does this really weird thing here with E flat, okay? So the right hand is playing an E flat 7 chord, while the left hand, the ostinato, appears to be in some form of either E Phrygian, that would account for that flat 2nd, or perhaps it's A minor, like that. It's not entirely clear from the score, but the fact is that he is doing something really interesting. Whatever you take to be the key center, it's a very mysterious sounding rub between that ostinato in the left hand and that E flat 7 chord in the right hand. It works in at least two ways. The dissonance puts us on edge, as we should be, you know, on the verge of a shark attack. And the very different principal lines being articulated depicts two worlds, the world above and beneath the waters of the ocean, the world of the totally primitive, the shark, belongs to the shark, and the world we live in. Another really great example, one of the best examples of how harmony in film music can kind of mess with your head, comes from James Newton Howard's wonderful score, textbook score for the film The Sixth Sense. Let's take a look at the scene where the Bruce Willis character, who, as you'll remember, plays a child psychologist working in the city of Philadelphia, who has this extraordinary encounter with a young boy named Cole, who sees dead people. Dead people come to him for help, for answers, for some sort of assistance. Well, in this scene, the Bruce Willis character, who has been counseling him throughout the film, realizes that he is, in fact, one of those, one of the dead. Here's what it looks like.
see them?
All the time. They're everywhere. They only see what they want to see.
Okay, Mikey. Come on. Give me a minute.
Let's talk about what he's doing there. I just mentioned that John Williams had used music to depict the world above the surface of the ocean, where we operate, and the world below that belongs to the shark. James Newton Howard's doing something very similar here in depicting the world Bruce Willis thought he was in, the world of the living, and the world he discovers in this scene he actually is in, which is the realm of the spirits, the world of shades, the world of the dead. One world is what he thought was true, and the other is what he's discovering. And this cue is all about the discovering of the truth, that he's dead. Now, you notice that he first comes to this epiphany when he realizes that he's not wearing his wedding ring, that his wife had it in her hands as she slept. Here's what James Newton Howard does. This is a mock-up of the beginning of this scene. That's the music that plays as he raises his hand into the light and sees that he's not wearing his ring. It's an incredibly important moment for both the character and for the audience, because we've been in the cinema for almost 2 hours with this film, fully believing that the Bruce Willis character is as alive as we are. And in this moment, we question everything. Some people even question whether they might be among the dead. And what has James Newton Howard done to achieve this effect? He's used bitonality in a different way from the way John Williams used it. But he's created a series of kind of polychords. There's essentially one harmony that tracks through the entire scene and another ascending line that tracks against that. Now, we don't hear this as something ugly or unnatural or particularly dissonant. We hear it as what it represents, which is a man coming to terms with the fact that what he thought was true is not. And when he finally realizes, when it all comes home to him, this is what happens. And again, this is my mock-up, so you'll forgive the fact that it doesn't quite sound like James Newton Howard. Thank you. Okay, so I use a thunderclap instead of a gunshot. I just couldn't find a gunshot. But anyhow, you can hear, again, if you want a deeper analysis of what's going on in this cue, you can check out my book, Scoring the Screen, The Secret Language of Film Music, which opens with a chapter on this very cue. And you'll get a more in-depth description of exactly what he's doing right there. But the point is, it ain't conventional harmony. It's not diatonic harmony. It's not what you learned in your early music theory classes. And if you're a songwriter, it's not even how you learn to write songs. An example I often use to illustrate what's so different about the harmonic language of film music comes, again, from the late, great, recently deceased Ennio Morricone, who scored those iconic spaghetti westerns, as well as films like The Mission, Cinema Paradiso. In 1974, he was asked to score an epic American saga called Days of Heaven. And it had been temp-tracked by its very, very smart and music-savvy director with a lot of really interesting music, both classical and folk. And one of the pieces featured heavily in the temp score was a piece known as The Aquarium from a larger piece by the French composer Camille Saint-Saëns called The Carnival of the Animals. Now, this is a really haunting piece of music with a core harmonic pivot between two chords that sounds just as strange now as it must have when it was written. The chords are A minor and B7 flat 5. B7 flat 5 sounds like that. Okay, so we're going back and forth from here to here. And this is, again, in a mock-up, what it sounds like at the beginning of the piece. Now, if you got really good pitch memory, you might be reminded when you hear that piece of the opening to Disney's Beauty and the Beast, the original animated film from 1992, which was also temped with this same piece of music. But getting back to Ennio Morricone and Days of Heaven in 1974, he was faced with a quandary, which you will all be faced with. The director loves this piece of music, this Saint-Saëns piece. I can't get rid of it. It's been in every cut of the picture so far, and it's used really prominently in the film. And it's a great piece of music. And I don't know if anything I write is ever going to be successful in replacing it. So you know what he did? He did what any great film composer, any film composer interested in maintaining his career and his relationship with directors, and also in satisfying the more important duty of serving the film and its story, he said, okay, I'm gonna figure out what it is he likes so much about that piece of music. And I'm going to schematically replicate that in a new piece of music. Now, I'm going to play the piece of music for you, and I'm going to show you reduction of the score so you can get a sense of what he did.
Thank you.
Okay. You hear, we don't have time to go back and revisit the chansons, but if you do that yourself, you'll hear immediately the common harmonic lineage of these pieces. But look at what he does here. Okay, here's where he begins on E major. Okay, now if we put this in second inversion, you can get more of a sense of what's going on. Again, those two chords do not come diatonically out of the same key center. So if you're going to try and do this with a key signature, you're going to have to use accidentals. So he starts off there on E major and C major. Two chords, two major triads separated by a major third. This is not root movement by fifths, as in classic harmony. It's root movement by thirds. It's mediant harmony, which is something you're going to be hearing a lot about as you study film music. But look at what he does. He starts off there. Right? He ends up that phrase on an E-flat major chord, and he gets there through the kind of voice leading that we've just been talking about. Then, when he restates the phrase, he's in a completely different key. He comes here, and then he comes here, so... And again, if I move to this voicing of the chord, you can get a better sense. And again, we're talking about major triads separated by a major third, root movement by thirds. That's how Ennio Morricone solved the problem of replacing this piece of music that was in the temp score with something of his own. Okay, so this stuff we're talking about, is there a way to visualize this graphically in the same way we were able to look at the circle of fifths? We were able to look at the set of triads based on the diatonic scale. We can put these on a standard, you know, musical staff and analyze them that way. But there's a more interesting way. And it dates back to the 19th century and probably even farther. It's called a tonitz. And again, comes to us from Germany. The tonitz links triads not by their function in a given key signature, such as dominant, tonic, but by their common tones. Here's what it looks like. So, since we've been hung up on C major for all of this lesson, let's start here with our C major triad. There it is. It's the downward pointing triangle. Now, by common tone, we can move from CEG to EGB. That would be like this. Very pretty change, completely diatonic, but useful in a lot of film music. Two common tones, you see? This vertex, I think that's what it's called, CEG, EGB. Now we can continue to move from here. We have two common tones, and we can go here, and we can go from here to here. So we've come right, going straight across, and we preserve two common tones in every single chord change. Now, if we do that right for strings, let's say, and we voice those strings properly, this is going to create incredibly fluid motion from chord to chord, which is exactly what we want in a film score. We don't want the audience to to stop for a second and go, wait, 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 what's that composer doing? What was that cadence I just heard? Ooh, that chord change sounds like something in an Adele song. You know, you don't want them doing that. You want them in the movie at all times. And in order to do that, your harmony has to be really smooth. Your voice leading has to be really smooth. Check out the Tonettes and explore what it sounds like to move from triad to triad across this map in all directions. You're going to come up with some fascinating sounding stuff, and you will surprise yourself, because after you play this and maybe record it in your DAW, you're going to think, whoa, that sounds like film music. I'm a film composer. So again, just to reiterate on the Tonettes, just so you can see what's happening here, each triad's represented by a triangle, major triads point down, minor triads point up. Each adjacent triad on the horizontal axis shares two common tones, as do the triads that share a bass. You play across the top row, you'll notice that only a single note needs to move in order to get to the new chord. This is the smoothest possible voice leading. Now, did famous, iconic, legendary film composers like Bernard Herrmann or Ennio Morricone know about the Tonettes when they wrote their most well-known scores? Probably not. Possibly. They found their way to these harmonic relationships by ear, by instinct. But in order to do that, their ears had to be freed from the straitjacket of a key signature. This is why we don't use key signatures in film music. Again, don't get me wrong. Giving your audience a sense of where musical home plate is at any given point in your cue can be very important. Except in scores for horror movies, film music is almost never really atonal. Like I said earlier, it's usually got a pedal, a drone, a pad, something that grounds it. Listen to this piece by the great Thomas Newman from his score for Revolutionary Road. It goes all over the map harmonically, but it never leaves us without a home. Beautiful, and no key signature, and the principal cadence in the cue is between C major, open fifth, and the two first notes of a D major triad, D and F sharp. Sorry. Right? He's got that pedal there to remind us that of where home is, but then he floats all over the place. Okay, so to wrap up, if you're an ear player and you're new to music theory, It may feel a little bit like I'm asking you to run before you can crawl with some of this stuff. We crammed a lot into this time. There's a bit of truth in that, but I think I can give you a better analogy. I'm asking you to feel before you think. To think in terms of musical pictures or storylines rather than musical abstractions based on theory that you learned years, maybe decades ago. One of those sayings that never get old is that you have to learn the rules before you can intelligently break them. Rules like functional harmony based on the circle of fifths have stood for centuries and are still the basis of most of the music we hear. You don't need to go all the way back to the music theory of Jean-Philippe Rameau, but an understanding of how the natural overtone series yielded modes based on subdivision of the octave and placement of intervals, and how those modes led to the canonization of the major and minor scales, and how harmony, as we now know it, resulted from the periodic consonances and dissonances created by the movement of voices, originally, literally, human voices. The movement of those voices in contrapuntal motion. And then eventually formalized those, those confluences of voice against voice into the study of harmony, into chords, and eventually chord progressions. All of that knowledge is really important so that you can then go out and score a film and break all those rules. I'll put that old saying in a slightly different way. The best reason to know the rules as an artist is so that you can break them. I hope this really compressed primer on music theory has given you some food for thought, and that you'll follow this trail of breadcrumbs to some fascinating and creative places. Next up, we're going to get a little bit into film music practice and how to use some of these tricks of the trade. So stick with me. Thank you.